I'm going to slightly indulge myself. It is true that I did speak here on the census after the 2000 experience. And in the audience was a close friend, Sid Verba. I just spent an hour and a half with Sid this afternoon. And I said to him, I think I would like to dedicate my lecture tonight to you. So with your permission, I'm dedicating. And Sid Wilson said, well, nobody's ever done that, I don't think. He wasn't certain. But I do want to kind of recognize that friendship. The actual title tonight is not what's on the book, because I have had to rewrite this thing every day for the last 3 weeks, including this morning as I was on the plane coming down and picking up the headlines about the new idea of let's even take citizenship away from citizens, not just immigrants who aren't there yet citizens, but so forth and so on. So I'm calling it the 2020 census three dimensions. The first dimension is the operational census. In 2000, I spent about 70 or 80% of the time talking about the operational census, how well it worked, what it was, what it tried to do, and so forth, and only a little bit about the politics, though they were important, but the ratio was about right. I think if Bob Groves, who as you just heard, is moderating one of our sessions tonight, were talking about the 2010 census, it would have been roughly the same thing. The operational census, the innovations, and so forth would have been the primary emphasis, with some reference to political situations and so forth and so on. But not tonight. I'm afraid I will get through the operational thing quickly, and then we will talk about the second dimension, which is the partisanization, if you will, politicization of the 2020 census. And then third dimension, which I will say very little about because it hasn't happened yet, but it's what we'll call the disrupted, disabled census. It is very vulnerable to what we saw in the 2016 election, and I will mention that just in passing. The operational census in 2020 is actually quite different from the census even in 2010. And that's because the Congress worried about the doubling of the cost of the census every decade. The census in 1990 was about $3.5 billion. The census in 2000 was about six and a half, double. And the census doubled yet again in 2010. And Congress said, no more. You got to slow down this growth. Now, the growth was a function of the population growing. Much, much more difficult to collect census data from every person once and only once and in the right place. That's the motto of the census. Count everyone once, only once, and in the right place. That's a big task in this country. 360 languages spoken, high degrees of mobility, a lot of disenchantment. We'll get to some of those things momentarily. But nevertheless, the census was told, the Census Bureau was told about 6 or 7 years ago, stop the growth of the cost and solve the problem with new technologies. So operationally, this particular census has now introduced three or four things that I will just briefly mention in passing. The first and most important, not the most important, but the first is that the 2000 census, the one I'm most familiar with, of course, was really, and that was also true of 2010 and all some previous ones the same way, was really two censuses. First, you have to go out and find every address in the country, every address where you think someone lives. You don't know if they live there or not, but you have to start with an address file. And then after, so that takes about a year of field work. And then you send the mailer to the address, and then you follow up, and we'll go through those things in a second. And that was repeated again largely in 2010. But in 2020, the address file was really constructed, has been constructed, by technologies. Mapping, the new ways in which we know where all the residences presumably are in the country, satellite imagery and so forth. So here's my position on that. We have gotten a report from the Census Bureau that it, and it's a big money saver, that they think it went very well, and that's good news. We don't know if it did until after the fact, of course. there will be false negatives and there will be false positives. There will be things we think are residences but aren't, and other places which are but we don't know that they are. So there'll be that problem, and we'll deal with that as we go on. But that's the first big transformation of the census in 2020 compared to the previous censuses. The second, again, innovation is an internet census. Every household which we presume to be online will get a mailer from the Census Bureau and saying, here's what we would like you to do. Here's your code, go online, fill out this form, send it back in, and so forth. If that works, and we've tested it somewhat, not as much as we wish we had have tested it for reasons we'll get to, but nevertheless, if that works, somewhere between 50 and 60% of the households will return their information through that through the internet. And that, again, is a huge money saver. It speeds up both the collection of the census, it speeds up the coding of it, the packaging of it, and so forth, and so on. The Census Bureau, as I just said, is pleased with what they've learned thus far about with one field test. They were supposed to have four, but they only had enough money to do one field test, what we call the end-to-end, just do the whole census in effect in one place. We're going to do it in four places, did it only in Providence. As I say, the Census Bureau is confident, but the GAO is more skeptical and saying they've overlooked a lot of things. We don't know how well the technology really does work. There are uncertainties about the IT systems, and there are many of them. Some 50 new IT systems are in place for the current census that's coming along. And we also know that, then I'll get back to this in a second, there's a much higher level of anxiety and fear about the census, so we don't know if it, however well it did work in one place, how well it's going to work across the entire country. And these are the kinds of things the GAO is bringing to our attention now. I should say that's standard practice. Everyone who's ever been connected to the census know the GAO overstates their anxieties and criticisms and concerns, and the Census Bureau slightly overstates its confidence and so forth. So that's the kind of a dance that goes on getting ready to do any census. After the internet phase of the census, the next major stage is to begin then to follow up where we did not get responses and expected to get a response. So this is a standard field effort. But again, they're going to use new technologies, both to take the data from the household and to ship it back to headquarters and so forth. It also depends upon recruitment of a labor force now that's going to go into the and do the field work. And there's some concern in this market, of course, about whether a labor force of the magnitude that we will need, depending on how well the internet census goes, will be forthcoming. And I'll, again, get back to that. Finally, there will be some people left outside of the census. We know we didn't find them. We thought we should have. We think that this is a residence. There are people living there and so forth. And we will use administrative records. Actually, most of us who are familiar with what's going on operationally are kind of confident about that. And we're kind of confident because we're getting much, much better at extracting information from administrative records, IRS records, school records, housing records, and so forth, and putting them together as best we can in order to describe who we think is in a given household and how many there are, and so forth. And the administrative record part of this, of course, has the huge, huge advantage that the public doesn't have to cooperate. We don't have to go find them and ask them anything. We'll just sort of go find them in the administrative record system and so forth. So that's kind of the reason that this census will feel different, because it will start with you getting a note, here's your internet address, please send it back in. You'll watch then the unfolding of the field based census of the people who have not yet responded, and then you won't know it, but in the back room, the rest of the cases we hope will be done through administrative records. The one thing about the 2020 which reproduces 2000 and 2010 is a huge advertising campaign and what we call partnership program or trusted voices. Up until 2000, if we wanted to advertise the census, which we did, we called PBS and said, do you mind mentioning the census on your, and so at 2 a.m. on Sunday morning, while you could go find out there was a census coming and so forth. We had never actually done a paid advertising campaign. And we made a huge investment, the country did a huge investment, more than $250 million, in creating paid advertising, as well as then the idea of partnerships. Let's talk some people into trying to help us do this thing. That became very big. It got expanded and made more sophisticated in 2010. We know how to do that. The census is good at finding partners and so forth. However, just one quick footnote, what we don't know is whether all the partners are going to step forward. I've been told, I don't know if this is a fact yet, but I've been told by somebody who says it is a fact, Walmart was one of our most important partners in 2000. Again, in 2010, they're not going to partner this year because they don't want to work with the Trump administration. So we simply, and that's a setback for us, of course, for the census. So we don't know how much of that is out there. We won't know until we just learn this, especially because, and I'll get to that, the citizenship question. Nevertheless, if we do have a, and I'll get to all of this in a second, wrap it all up, but I want to just make it clear to you that this component of the census, a huge effort to engage the public in actually, in chambers of commerce and the Catholic Church and Walmart and chambers of commerce and so forth, is a key element of the 2020 census. And if it goes as well as it did in 2000 and 2010, we'll be in fairly good shape, we think. But we just don't know until it plays out. So that's the rather rushed through the operation, just so you know that the census has these new things. There are budgetary uncertainties. The Bureau does not have a confirmed director. They have a very talented acting director, but he's just a civil servant. He's not been confirmed by the Senate. That gives him less clout, if you will, in the system. When reporters push me for a judgment about 2020, based just on the operations, I say, well, in fact, I will settle for a census as good as 1990. I do not think we will. We are accustomed to every census being better than the previous one. And in different ways we define that, including count everyone wants, only wants, and in the right places, no undercounts, smaller overcounts, and so forth. We have measures of what we consider to be a good census. And censuses have been steadily better because the technology and the sophistication gets better and better. I can see the census as a slipping backwards from what we accomplished in 2000 and 2010. But even a census of the quality of 1990 is good enough to work with. It won't be a failed census. We'll use the numbers. We'll be unhappy at the increased undercount and maybe overcounts, but we'll work our way around those challenges. However, and now I have to shift to the second dimension, which is what I call the partisan census of now. We've always had a partisan census, as John just said in his opening comments. There have always been politics. Adams and Jefferson, by the way, came up with alternative formulas for how to run the reapportionment process. And guess what? Adams gave a seat to Massachusetts that Jefferson took away and gave to Virginia. And George Washington was the jury in this particular moment. And he says, well, I have to think Jefferson's is better. So Virginia got a seat that otherwise would have gone to Massachusetts. The 0.6 count of the slavery is a huge, of course, a partisan decision. It basically saved slavery for another half century. Because we counted the African Americans, they of course weren't allowed to be voters or anything like that, but we counted them in the census as 0.6 of a person until after the Civil War. So the census has always had, 1920 is another interesting example of funny kind of partisanship. Did a good census by and large. Nobody had any big complaints about it, except it turned out it first time recorded the country as more urban than rural. Oh boy, there were people nervous about that finding, and especially in the Midwest and in the southern, southwestern states. It was going to move 11 seats from rural states to the Northeast. 1920, Red Scare. All these commies up in Pittsburgh and Cleveland, we're going to give them the extra 11 seats? So after the 1920 census, we did not reapportion. They just didn't do it. Nobody could make them do it. And so they actually left those 11 seats in their states for a decade. So anyway, yeah, they're politics. They're always politics. The sampling fight in 2000 was, but I want to say one thing about the politics before we dig more deeply into 2020. The sampling fight in 2000, which I lived through, basically was not an attempt to benefit the Democrats, even though that was the accusation. It was an attempt to count everyone. Fundamentally, a successful census is a complete count of the entire population, as I said, no overcount, no undercount, and everybody in the right place. If you achieve that, you actually benefit the Democrats. But that's just the nature of the demography. It's not because that's why you did it. You did it because you want a good census. It's just like if everyone voted, the Democratic Party would probably win in 2018 and 2020 and so forth. But they don't all vote, and that part of the reason is voter suppression, which, again, we'll mention in a second. But the oddity of our politics right now is the most attractive thing you want for the country, which is a complete count, with data that I'll give you in a second, is going to be disadvantage one of the parties and reward the other party. And that is kind of a difficult place to be. If you want to structure the census to make sure that, better find my watch so I can not lose signal if I'm going on too long, John. Yep, good. I'm just getting started. The easiest way, the best way to try to construct a census which will disproportionately benefit one of the parties or the other is by passing some laws that will help you do that. It's like the voter suppression stuff. If you gerrymander, if you don't let felons vote, if you say that in order to kind of be a voter, you have to prove your citizenship, if you haven't voted for the last two or three elections in this state, then you don't get to vote in the next one. You can actually pass laws that, of course, torture the electorate into an electorate which is more likely to be favorable to one party as against another. In the census space, what would be equivalent to voter suppression and gerrymandering? And I'm going to quote from a kind of a conservative website, because they are people thinking very hard what I'm about to say about this. Because illegal aliens should not even be in the country, and other non-immigrants, such as foreign students and guest workers, are here only temporarily, it makes no sense to distribute congressional seats as if these foreign nationals deserve representation the same as American citizens. This is a reasonable position. It's not constitutional, but that doesn't mean you can't change the rules. You can change the Constitution. But it's not, if I can see it as a citizen of America, that's a reasonable position. Why should these foreign students who are only here two or three years doing their postdocs or whatever, why in the world are we putting them in the middle of the electorate? They don't have a stake in this country the way in which the rest of us do, who live here, have houses, raising our children, and so forth. Another sentence from this website. The U.S. population that logically should be enumerated includes U.S. citizens and legal permanent residents, as only the former may vote in federal elections. By the way, non-citizens can vote in state and local elections. The apportionment of seats in Congress should be on the basis of the number of U.S. citizens in each state, that is, recent citizens as well as current citizens. As well as historic citizens, legacy citizens, all of us who were born here and naturalized here, and so forth. And we'll get back to again what Trump is now saying about that. Indeed, if apportionment based on U.S. citizenship had been in place in the 2010 census, 9 seats in the House would have shifted. The big loser would have been California, 5 seats, if you had not included the non-citizen population. And Texas lost 2 seats. Florida and New York won each, and then the other, those 9 seats would have been spread against, across 9 other states. So this is not a dumb idea, that if you would like to have a electorate which better represents the citizens of the country, let's kind of create a census that gives us the population count that will do that. And therefore, let's not put non-citizens into the count that goes into the reapportionment numbers. Because they infect, by counting the entire population, even the illegals, you are disproportionately benefiting the Democratic Party. There's simply no doubt about that. The 40 million immigrants, including legal and illegal, citizens and non-citizens, the 40 million immigrants in the 2010 census redistributed 18 seats. 16 of those seats went to states that voted for Obama in 2012. From a partisan perspective, immigration benefits the Democrats. It just does. And that's the dilemma that is faced, not the dilemma, but the challenge that's now faced by the 2020 census. This redistribution caused by immigration tends to take representation away from states comprised mostly of U.S. citizens and gives it to states where a larger share are non-citizens. And for certain parts of the population, that just doesn't seem right. And we overlooked for a long time that a lot of people were getting very angry at some things they didn't think were right or fair, like affirmative action and so forth, as we all now know in retrospect. So is it possible to fix this problem through the courts? I can tell you that the quotes I've just read go all the way back to 1929. When they were trying to take what they called aliens out of the census by rewriting the Constitution. That project has been on. It's like the new federalism and the court stuff and so forth. There have been a group of people working on this now for some time, and the conditions are simply different this year than they were prior to this year. Just no doubt about that and so forth. The text that they're using, constitutional text, is from the 14th Amendment. You will read many, many times, if you're following any of the court cases about 2020, that the 14th Amendment says, representatives shall be apportioned among the several states according to their respective numbers, counting the whole number of persons in each state, excluding Indians not taxed. That's the 14th Amendment trying to sort out the situation that, of course, the Civil War had left us. However, that's Section 2. Section 1 is this language. All persons born or naturalized in the United States and subject to the jurisdiction thereof are citizens of the United States and of the state wherein they reside. The legal case starts with Section 1 and says this 14th Amendment is actually talking about citizens, not just all people. And so when you get to the second phrase that I just read, and don't have to memorize these kinds of things, just trust me. I'm trying to get it right. There is now, I've tested this out with lawyers. All of my lawyers tend to be of one persuasion, I'm afraid. And they said, don't worry about this at all. The idea in the second section of the whole number of persons is intended to reproduce the argument in the Constitution itself, which was a count of residents in the country, not of citizens. We do know that if they are successful, and I don't want to try to make any guesses about whether this they can get a favorable ruling or not. I just can't predict what this court will do. But thus far, with respect to census stuff, there haven't been many rulings yet, but the rulings have all gone clearly in the direction of sort of giving the Republicans what they want. The Secretary of Commerce was asked to be deposed about the citizenship question, and he said no, and the Supreme Court said, okay, you can't depose him. The court case on citizenship will start, the next one is supposed to start on November 5th, just a few days, of course, from now, and there's now a request by the administration to delay that. So we simply don't know how the courts are going to rule on this thing. But at least that's the simple way to solve this from the point of view of the Republican Party. The simplest way to solve the citizenship problem, the immigration problem, the disproportionate benefit it gives to the Democratic Party is to solve it by a law. Short of that, if they don't get a favorable ruling, then that takes us to the citizenship question. This is adding a question on the short, what we call the short form on the actual decennial census, the one that will be when we send it to you and say, please return your answer by the internet. This does not have a citizenship question on it. I won't go through the details of this. I can do it in Q&A if I want. We don't need the citizenship number from that census in terms of what the citizens, we have data on citizenship. We have very good data. We know how many they are, roughly where they are, and so forth. But by putting it on the short form or on the major census that goes out, it's a big statement to the country. It goes to 100% of the households. It says that this is really important, whether you're a citizen or not a citizen. And not only that, the question includes, and when did you come here? So it's going to be a very big statement. That's why there's 6 court cases, you know, arguing about this. There is plenty of evidence that adding the citizenship question will have statistical consequences. We've done a test in 2016 using other data. The non-response rate for citizenship is of what we call item non-response. You get a questionnaire and you answer it all, but you don't answer this question. In 2016, before the talk about the decennial in 2020, 6% of the households did not answer that question, or 6% of the respondents did not answer that question. That is 3 times the rate of any other item that's on the census. It just ballooned as soon as you put that question on. You just expect people not to want to answer it. And indeed, the same thing was entire households. Households where there was a non-citizen, something like 5-6% of the households simply didn't send the questionnaire back in at all, even if there's only one non-citizen in the household and so forth. There have been polls now, the Latino poll, that roughly 68% of the Latino population in this poll believes that if they answer a citizenship question, it will be used against them. It's just not a statistic, it's part of the mechanism by which they will be rounded up and deported. 7% of the United States population are not citizens. 14% of the American population live in households which have at least one non-citizen. And we have a lot of evidence already that you can be in a household with some citizens and some non-citizens, but if there's some that aren't citizens, this is not a form that's likely to come back in. And these are largely, of course, recent immigrants, Asians, and Latinos. 45% of Hispanics, Latinos, and Asians live in households with at least one non-citizen. We are afraid this is going to be from a point of view of statistics, of responding to the census, we're afraid we're setting ourselves up for a really not very good census, I'd put it that way. Indeed, the projections are that if you put a citizenship question on the census, we will move about 10 seats, mostly from blue states to red states. Again, California is the big loser. Texas is a loser. The seats they lose, by the way, are Democratic seats in terms of where these people are concentrated. But nevertheless, Texas itself will lose. Bear in mind that when you lose in the census, you're not only losing electoral seats, electoral college votes, and House seats, you're losing money, large amounts of money. The total amount of money that will be spent between 2020 and 2030 from the federal government, going back to the states, for various kinds of programs, is about $9 trillion. So if your share of that is somehow shrunk and somebody else is elaborated or accelerated, then there are some states that are going to come out ahead and some locales that are going to come out ahead. And that's big money, and I'll get to that in a second. So let me try to summarize this part of the consequences of the question by turning to Houston, because it's a nice little case study, and I found some good quick data on it all and so forth. They just had a meeting. The mayor just convened a meeting, and the headline of that meeting was Houston's $6 billion census problem, frightened immigrants. And here's what the mayor of Houston did. He collected people from universities, politicians, local judges, chambers of commerce, commercial players, and said, what are we going to do? We're about to lose a lot of money if we have to have this citizenship question on the form. And then they quoted one of the persons, Espinoza, a U.S. citizen by birth, but who lives with undocumented relatives. She has no intention of answering the census because she worries it expose other members of the family and they will be deported. In a region where 37% of immigrants are undocumented, the largest in the country, by the way, by percent, the 2020 census has been a problem of crisis management. Every person who goes uncounted creates a loss in federal funding, and so forth and so on. Texas itself will lose approximately 1,161 in federal funding for each person not counted. Over $1,000 for any single person that should have been counted in Texas that is not counted. If you multiply that, for example, by the number of, by just for Houston, where they estimate about 506 unauthorized immigrants, that's $6 billion across 10 years. That's what led to that that headline. They've got a $6 billion problem created by frightened immigrants. And by the way, that's an underestimation because that's really basically on Medicaid and Medicare dollars, and there are more grant monies than just in those two programs, although that's a very large share of it. Nearly a third of the population in a study that the Census Bureau did in Houston and Los Angeles in Hispanic neighborhoods, nearly a third of the population did not respond to the survey, even after six retries by enumerators, knocking on the door six different times after a day, after another day, after another day, and so forth and so on, 30%. And that was before, this is 2016, before any talk of the citizenship issue. And it's, I'll just, the mayor, by the way, Houston is doing, getting the churches involved, getting people to donate money, getting the media to try to be free, talking to the TV stations, creating this trusted voices. They themselves are trying to recreate what the federal government did in 2010 and 2000 because they don't trust the federal government to come down and work in Houston the way that they have been doing in previous censuses. So they're using their own strategies and so forth. And here's the mayor wrapping up his meeting. Don't worry. No one is going to take the information and use it against you or your family members. But who's going to believe it? The mayor believes it. I mean, he believes, he's saying it. He's not trying to mislead people. But can he deliver? Now, some version of Houston is playing itself out in thousands of cities and towns where local efforts are being organized, of the chambers of commerce, of the churches, the department stores, the whatever it takes, the schools. There's a huge groundswell of effort to kind of compensate for the anxiety about what the federal government is or is not going to do. There are resource problems. Mesa, Arizona, which has a Republican mayor, 45% Hispanic population, and he is tearing his hair out, I can tell you. I just met with him about what to do about this, but he just does not see that his population is going to answer this form, whatever he puts together and so forth. And he's got limited resources. He's got four or five people working on this, but he doesn't have money to do the kind of outreach that he needs. The kind of end point of that little set of analyses is that you really cannot compensate with what the federal government's responsibility with respect to the census. You can do good work at the edges, and we've done extremely good work with partnerships and so forth and so on at the edges. But fundamentally, without a big budget for advertising and for having partnership experts and so forth, and that just money hasn't materialized yet. Then finally, and I hate to sound so partisan, quite honestly. I've talked about the census on and off and written about the census for 20 years. I believe deeply in the enterprise, of course, without trying to sound partisan. But it's very hard today not to be. Call the cards as they are. We simply do not know whether the Census Bureau itself will be constricted in ways that have a political intent. It's easy, quite easy, for the Department of Commerce to be selective in how it allocates its budget. It's easier to give a contract to Fox News than to CNN, if that's what you want to do. It's easier to, we've already done this, not to allow non-citizens in the 2010 census were hired as enumerators very successfully. They know the language, they know the neighborhoods, they can talk people into cooperating and so forth. The Census Bureau today has been prevented from hiring non-citizens, even legal citizens, having nothing with the illegals. But anybody not a citizen cannot work for the Census Bureau right now. And that includes, by the way, some very sophisticated statisticians in the leadership of the Census Bureau, which are now being asked to quit their work. Now, there are states in which President Trump is actively campaigning today, and will between now, of course, in the 2016, next week, and then again, of course, 2018, and then again, of course. There are states that he is comfortable in, and that he goes to, and that he rouses the population and so forth. I don't know what the man will do, but what if he decides he only wants to push the census in the states that he knows are favorable? What are we going to do? I don't have an answer to that question. That sounds very, very partisan. I know the Census Bureau will fight back, but I know the Census Bureau has limited equipment with which to fight back. Now, if that is the end of it, if we just have high levels of item non-response on the citizenship question, we can still put a census together. It'll be weak. It won't be strong numbers. It won't be accurate across the country. It'll be differential in some parts and so forth and so on. But we will have a census that is usable, is my best hope. However, this now takes me to the third dimension of the census, which is, of course, what happened in the 2016 elections from Russia. Who knows who wants to disrupt this census? We know it's out there. We do not know how big it will be. It may not be big at all. It may be, not that interesting. People won't pick it up. But I can tell you it's easy. Census is a big target. It's visible. It's on the billboards if we have the advertising money. It's on the media. All this effort coming up in some of the local communities is a big, visible thing. And it's really easy to say through social media today, we don't think you want to cooperate with that census if you're an Hispanic or an Asian or a non-citizen or you have some problem in your family or whatever, so we would advise you to stay away from it. Very easy to shoot that message out across the social media. It's very easy to create fake news stories. By the way, you don't have to answer the census. The census isn't due until the end of the year. Anytime between the between now, April, and the end of the year is soon enough to send your form back, so don't worry about it. It would not be difficult to mess up a census if you want to do so. I think if there's hacking, the Census Bureau will do a good job at stopping that. I don't think people's responses will be vulnerable. But all kinds of other fake stuff is very difficult for the Census Bureau to fight. I conclude the operational census, even with adequate funding and no inappropriate interference, will probably be less complete and less accurate than the 2010 or 2000 census, but marginally so. So numbers, but not the best numbers we ought to be having. That's the operational census alone. Throw in the partisan census is a huge wrench into the system with consequences really hard to predict. But if there is an untested census question, item non-response will certainly challenge the usefulness of at least that data. And I should say there are Hispanic efforts to sort of create a movement in which everybody answers the question, but everybody just ticks the census box, citizenship. Yes, I'm a citizen. That makes the data useless, of course, because they're not all citizens. But that they could do. Anybody who tried to organize that would probably go to jail, but I don't think the country's equipped to go out and find 40 or several millions and millions and millions of people and say you answered the question wrong and you have to go to jail. That won't happen. If, however, there's household non-response of a magnitude of 6, 8, 10%, then we're in deep hole with respect to even if we have operable a number at the end of the day. So I can tell you there are conversations right now going on, this gets into Jonathan's final point, about what will we do if we really have a bad census, if we really have ineffective numbers, will we be able to create a momentum that would require it to be done again under different kinds of rules, and I can't begin to think through the answer to that question. And then secondly, there are some of us very, very concerned about the 2020 census, and we'd like to create a 2030 census that avoids these problems that we're having today. And we think we have a way in which to do that, and there are people working on the 2030 census. We'll make it even more unlike the 2030, the 2020, and the 2020 was like the 2010. But here's the big price. The idea that you could have a Republican census versus a Democratic census is simply unprecedented. The census was never belonged to a party. The census floated above that as this kind of shared number system that allowed us to govern our country. And it was almost like it's one of the few big civic celebrations we ought to have, where we all do have a common commitment to having a decent count of our communities and our neighborhoods and our states and our little cities and townships and so forth. It just pains me to say that, but if this thing becomes so politicized that there is a Democratic census and a Republican census and they are different, I don't actually know what that means, except I know it's a very sad place for the country to be. And if there's a disrupted census, just all bets are off. I mean, a serious disrupted census of fake news and fake threats and so forth. Sorry. That's how I see it.